Use the right, rich and famous people as role models for good health. Now, here we have to be a little cautious and use the people who are rich and famous and who have consistently shown responsible practices. We don't want to be using somebody who has a negative image because of drinking or drugs or some other issue. People, for one reason or another, follow the celebrities. So let's find the ones who can be the government spokesperson, health plan spokesperson, for encouraging people to adopt the right practices. See, 5 or 7 years ago, the campaign for milk mustache changed the whole country. Everybody started understanding value of milk, importance of milk, and our milk consumption increased. Of course, there was more result to show it is good, but it suddenly made people stop in their tracks and think about it. Now is the time to use the right celebrities to do the same with the message we have, and this should be on a non-commercial, non-bias basis, and this will give us a very good return on our investment in raising the awareness for population at large. So use of right, rich and famous people as role models for good health gets a B+ from us in terms of priority. Correct the MCGs or medical care gaps. This is a presentation in itself, and we have 1 hour plus, actually I think it is 2 hour presentation on MCGs or medical care gaps as a separate presentation. In nutshell, medical care gaps are the basic cause for increased hospital admissions in the country. These are those gaps in your care that will take you to emergency room, get you admitted in the hospital, maybe cause you a heart attack, stroke, blindness, kidney failure, or some such thing which will cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, and they are all preventable. They are all preventable by spending less than $100 per medical care gap compared to spending $100,000 per medical care gap, and each person can have from 10 to hundreds of gaps or MCGs in their care. This is a topic very close to our heart, because with this one everybody wins. With this one, those holes in the sieve, that bottom in the bottomless pit, is taken care of. So correcting the MCGs or medical care gaps gets an A++ from us. Now, tax the rich strategy. Not a good idea, because we are supporting an addiction to poor quality care, a wrong habit of getting poor quality care. So we can tax rich to 90% limit, doesn't matter. We will be throwing good money after bad if we do not change the approach to quality of care that we receive. So taxing the rich gets F- from us. Tax the Cadillac health plans or golden health plans, whatever they call. Again, same reason that we gave for taxing the rich. First, we are supporting a bad habit, which will cost us even more in the long run. And the second is, ultimately, everybody will game the system and they will develop products beating the system. So, and that is not the American way to do things, I believe, that we selectively tax something or somebody to give the money away to someone else. So taxing the Cadillac health plans gets an F minus from us. Taxing health insurance companies. This is not a good idea because we were talking about Cadillac plans and gold plans and all that. It is not a good idea for a few reasons. First, they will ultimately game the system and they will develop products bypassing the tax sooner or later. Also, it is not a big money generator. We will probably spend more money trying to collect this tax than to really tax. This is not the best way to generate revenue. There are other better ways, and we have discussed many other ways in this presentation. We are of the opinion that health insurance purchase should be post-tax. Now, there can always be an argument about people who do not make enough money, and there can be a limit, sort of much lower limit than what it is today, or there can be some other sort of subsidy that if you make less than $20,000, then government will pay your co-pays or something like that. But the bubble that has been created in the healthcare industry because of undesired consequences which nobody thought of by providing pre-tax premiums need to gradually shrink and disappear before it bursts. So taxing health insurance companies, Cadillac plans, etc. gets a D from us. Let the medical talent be on the government side. By that, what I mean is that whether it is a financial system or whether it is other major system research, many a times the talent ends up going into the private sector. And the reason for that is those who are talented like to work in uncontrolled environment that permits experimentation and that rewards achievement. That's a tall order for any government anywhere in the world, because government machinery runs with much more stricter rules and regulations, and that's fair. But the government can benefit tremendously by using the talent, and then a middle path can be that this talent can be hired as consultant. The problem comes that when many a times government hires consultants, there is a lot of paperwork which talented people are the last to do, and many so-called consultants become consultants because of nepotism, cronyism, and all those isms. And then the very purpose is defeated. Maybe the government can ask the talent to rotate through the government for a year or two, working for the government. Right now, there is good talent in terms of administration, probably. But really good medical talent need to be a part of the government's offensive on the poor quality of health to start with, and They have to find a way to do that. So, getting medical talent on the government side at federal and state level is very important. Not just the famous people, famous doctors, famous nurses, famous activists, famous politicians, no. They should be the talented people who have solutions to problems that are innovative solutions. So getting the medical talent on government side gets an A+ from us. Let the health plans deal with all providers. Now, I know many of you have reservations about health plans, and I'm not a fan of them either, but I am a realist. The situation today is there is not a single agency in the country which has such strong relationship with all the stakeholders in patient care. Pharmacy, radiation technologist, x-ray technician, physician, nurse practitioners, physical therapist, you name it, and they touch every healthcare provider directly or indirectly. Not one agency in the country can do that at this moment. So instead of beating them up and ultimately suffering ourselves, what we need to do is to give the health plan a better mandate. That is what they have to achieve. And those who consider health plans to be like a bully, think of it like when you can't beat the bully and you need to cross the jungle, you want to use the bully to cross the jungle. And we are in a thick of jungle. And this bully can at least help us get through that jungle. The health plans should be asked to manage all these providers in a way that everything is streamlined to provide you as a patient the highest quality of care. And they can do it. Believe me, they can do it. If the government wants to do it tomorrow, they need to hire like a million employees. And you know how million employees with the government will work after 10 years or 5 years. So let's use the health plans before we write them off. And again, I am not a fan of them, but I know when it will be a disaster to change the course so suddenly, and that's why I say what I say. If these plans don't perform according to what we wish, we can do so much to change their behavior in 6 months. But there should be commitment on the part of the administrative side from the monitoring agencies to see that change come. But in the short term, it will be the best strategy to use them to get what we want. So let the health plans deal with all providers gets A- in terms of priority from us. Food safety, raw food and restaurant food safety. It is a must, and this thing should be free of political bickering and pressures. Because what ends up happening that we or our loved ones may one day be the consumer of that bad food, whether it was spinach or peanuts or whatever. And so this is one topic where politics should not be a part, and there should be clear guidelines and policies and punishments about food safety, which should be strongly implemented throughout the country for everybody to win from these policies. Right now we have policies, right now we have some guidelines, but they are not neither strong enough nor their implementation is strong enough, and big companies get away with, I don't have a better word, so I will call it murder, when people die from Salmonella or E. coli poisoning and the company knew about it and did not stop it from spreading. It's a murder, but they get away because we are not strong enough in our conviction of implementing these policies. The thing is, I am not against anybody. Once the rules become strict for everybody, then everybody is paying the same price to implement those policies, and so nobody will complain. So if there are A, B, C, D, E, five companies and all the five have to follow a rule, all the five will spend equivalent money on that, so nobody can complain. It is only we who are missing in our conviction to demand good quality of food safety. So food safety of raw and restaurant food gets an A minus. Random unannounced checking of inpatients' charts will help improve quality of care. In our other presentation on medical care gaps or MCGs, we have shown that even if you are admitted with heart failure, the national data shows that there are 25% chances that you will not be getting the care you should have been getting. And this leads to prolonged hospitalization, subacute nursing home care, disability, and so much more. So a random unannounced checking of inpatient chart for various conditions can help tremendously improve inpatient quality of care. So random unannounced checking of patient chart gets an A minus from us. Penalty for unnecessary admissions. Right now the rule of the game is that if a patient is admitted unnecessarily, the health plan doesn't pay for it. I don't think anybody in Medicaid or something even can easily even check that right now. However, the rule should be that if a patient is admitted unnecessarily, the hospital has to pay a fine. The reason the patient is admitted is that the patient cannot see a specialist or a doctor who should have seen the patient when the patient is in emergency room, or the hospital doesn't provide some services on a weekend like leg Doppler or something. And that should not be the case. Hospitals, just like illnesses, should be 7/24. Illness doesn't wait that today is Saturday or Sunday, so a person won't be ill. And when a person is ill on a Friday evening, he or she doesn't deserve care on Monday morning. He or she deserves care on Friday evening. And hospitals can do it because there is not a push for hospitals to work 7/24. It is like police, it is like military. They work 7/24. It is not that the police station is closed on Saturday or Sunday. It is not that the army doesn't work on Sunday. No. So same way the hospitals are something which are part of fire, police like services, and there is no reason that the patient should be unnecessarily admitted because the hospital decides to close some departments on weekends because it is not cost effective. It can be cost effective. They can keep the person on call or something, but to admit a patient when the admission really is not required is almost criminal, and somebody should pay the price. Right now, there is not even financial penalty for doing so. So penalty for unnecessary admissions gets a B minus from us. Electronic medical records. We talked about the platform for electronic medical records earlier. We also have to evaluate the electronic medical records themselves. The research has not yet shown that electronic medical records make a difference in quality of care. I personally do not fully agree with that research, but that is what the outcome is. Maybe 10 years later, when another study is done, it will be shown that they did make a difference. But to date, there has not been a good conclusive study showing that EMRs make or electronic medical records make a difference in quality of healthcare. So when we decide to choose a platform for electronic medical records, we should ask ourselves the first question: what are the goals of electronic medical records that we want to adopt? Is the goal to save costs? Is the goal to improve quality of care? Is the goal to improve efficiency? Is the goal all of the above? And we have to have our goals written very clearly along with timelines, that what goal we want to achieve by what percentage, by what time, and keep reevaluating it from time to time. In my personal opinion, even though today there is no proof that electronic medical records improve the quality of care, I believe that done right, they will give an excellent result in 10 to 20 years time. But if done wrong, they can be a disaster of epic proportions and will push us back by at least 5 years in terms of quality of care, or even more. So this is something which need to be immediately tested and tried on a small market and evaluated rapidly and then adopted, rather than adopted first and then all the rest of the things done. This EMR can be one single thing which can double or triple our healthcare costs, severely decrease our quality of care, and can be a disaster if right choices are not made. And if right choices are made, it can significantly improve our quality of care. So I am all for EMRs, but a right decision for the EMR is more important. It is of paramount importance for the country as a whole. Electronic medical records gets A minus in terms of priority. Pump more money in the current healthcare system as strategy? Very bad idea, because it's like pouring water onto a sieve. It is a bottomless pit. Unless you close the holes called medical care gaps. Each hole is one medical care gap. Each medical care gap is a potential expense of at least $100,000 plus disability. And unless we, you can imagine the trillions of dollars we can end up spending if we don't fix the MCGs or medical care gaps. So we have to stop the hemorrhage from MCGs first, and then we won't even need to pour the money, because there is so much money going towards healthcare already. 16% of our GDP, it's a huge money. So pump more money in the current healthcare system gets F minus from us. Health fairs. I found that health fairs give the best value for the dollar when you want to detect new cases in society of, say, high blood pressure, diabetes, or something like that. And also everybody has fun at health fairs. Either the government directly can have stalls in health fairs, or can support the charities to sponsor that stall or have that stall checking for common things. It is a very efficient utilization of money, and I think we should find more ways to provide screening during different types of fairs, not only health fairs. So health fairs get A plus from us in terms of priority. Let Medicare be not the one first to approve everything. Till now, the criteria is that Medicare is almost always the first to approve anything new, be it a device, be it a medication. Some of these approvals are later proven to be costly and wrong decisions. The problem is that what Medicare approves, the health plans have to approve, because the Medicare approves it, and most of them follow the Medicare. I believe that Medicare should ask for or demand for much stronger data and evidence before they accept something for approval. Sometimes I can understand denying something can be difficult, but if there is an incidence like that, then it could be put on fast track. For example, a medicine comes that can treat HIV or breast cancer or something, and the company pushes that, oh, FDA has approved it, so you should approve it, or some device comes. I think Medicare has to, maybe they can deal with the company that in terms of payments or something, that they will not pay for 2 years, or they will only pay half the money or something, because they are supporting that company tremendously by doing so. And right now I don't think there is much negotiation authority with Medicare. So a lot of expenses which become like automatic expenses for health plans because Medicare approved it can be prevented by a more judicious approach in terms of Medicare approval policies. So let Medicare be not the one first to approve everything gets an A plus from us. Easier patient access to medical records. On paper, every patient through patient's bill of right has access to his or her medical records, But this is far from true. Try getting a copy of your medical records from your provider's office or your hospital. It's a Herculean task. Maybe when the electronic medical records come, you can carry your medical record in a USB drive or on something like that, or a DVD or a CD. But right now, it is extremely difficult. And even though there are laws on paper, it is difficult to say the least. So we must find a way to make it easier for the patient to access his or her medical records with the purpose of correcting them if they are wrong and having them when they are needed. So easier patient access to medical record gets a C from us in terms of priority. Monitor websites where patients share medical experience. Now there's so many social media websites, and the best way to describe it is that the blind is leading a blind. What I mean by that, I give an example. Like 6 months ago, somebody posted a question online. I am 16 years old and I found out in doctor's office today that I am pregnant. What should I do? And within 5 hours, there were like 700 replies telling the girl to pray hard, to get abortion, to not get abortion, to eat this and don't eat that. And that can be very confusing to the patient. There was also advice which was detrimental to the patient's health and well-being. But there's no control on such advice. Similarly, when you see the data on medical care gaps, we get 50% of the care we are getting even as patients. So if somebody has diabetes or high blood pressure or any other medical illness, chronic medical illness, he or she is getting 50% of care he should have received. And now this person who himself or herself is not getting medical care is advising another patient about healthcare. And that is where I say blind is leading the blind. When it comes to cooking recipes, that's fine. But unfortunately, the social media is playing such an important role, and businesses, many of them not considering the patient's best interest, are selling all sort of snake oil on social medias. So somebody should be monitoring these websites. I know it won't be easy. I know First Amendment will not let us do many things that you would like to do, but just the thought of somebody is watching can minimize the bad effects of wrong exchange of information on these websites. So, monitoring websites where patients share medical experience gets C minus from us. There is even a better solution than monitoring social media websites, and that is that the government takes the initiative and starts its own social media website for health. Nothing wrong in that. So now a government-run or sponsored website through, say, NIH can create chat rooms and platform where patients can get real good information. I haven't seen any social media website from any government agency. Why can't they have one? They have a website. I'm sure they can have chat rooms where highly trained, educated physicians will be willing to give the right advice to the patient. Such social networks are the future because the government can use them during emergencies like flu. When Facebook and MySpace, etc., can send out messages to 60 million people at the click of a mouse, why can't the government do the same thing? Why can't the government use that power? It's already 2 or 3 years late, but the government should be able to use social media sites that they create for dealing with emergencies, health education, and informing about policy. Run health social networking groups on the web by the government strategy gets an A plus from us. Stop drug imports from other countries. There are many reasons to it. One is it takes away jobs from America. The second is, whatever they may say, the quality can be difficult to monitor. The third thing is, when the same pharmaceutical companies can create or can make that product or sell that product at 10 times lower price in other countries, somebody should sit down with them and ask them questions and ensure that we get a reasonable pricing structure so that we can produce our medication in our own country, providing job to our own people, and a process that we can control closely, we can monitor closely. So, stopping drug imports from other countries gets a B plus from us. Negotiating rate discounts with pharmaceutical companies is part of that normal business, that part of that common sense we talked about, that is a part of doing normal business. It should have started 2 decades ago or even more. And we are glad that at least now it's happening. Negotiating rate discounts with US pharmaceutical companies gets a B plus from us. Research and innovation. This is our best hope to get the best level healthcare, best quality healthcare at the lowest price. And we have to focus more on research and innovation, not necessarily in medical care only, but in how to provide that medical care to the patients. Research and innovation gets A from us. Mandatory rural area rotations, a part of medical internship. Make rural area rotations mandatory after all medical internship training. It's a shame that most of rural Midwest has such low density of doctors and other providers, as no one wants to go there. Northeast and Southwest, they have excess capacity. Now, one advantage that it will give will be during this rotation, the interns will learn about various local customs and practices and how the life is, and some of them may end up liking it and then staying there after their internship is over, and we don't even have to train new people, this may have an immediate effect. So the government should define areas that are underserved with medical care, and the new residents or interns should be sent there for 2 to 3 months out of the 1 year training. So mandatory rural area rotation as part of medical internship gets a B plus from us. More middle and lower level health workers. We immediately need more physician assistants, medical assistant, health educators, home health aides. But remember, once we choose, once we give our kids an opportunity to join these professions, this should not be the dead end for them. Because these are some of the brightest kids who, because they did not have money or they had to support their families, went into those professions. So we should immediately increase the number of these lower and middle level health workers with a possibility that they can continue to become a nurse or a doctor if they continue to gain knowledge and experience. And there again, everybody will win. So we will immediately decrease unemployment. We will immediately have hands to help our healthcare industry that it doesn't fall apart. And those who are willing to work hard will get an opportunity to excel. So more middle and lower level health workers gets an A plus from us. Correct the fragmentation of healthcare that exists now. Currently, our healthcare is extremely fragmented. If we continue on the same path, it will be much more fragmented. Fragmentation is expensive. I give you an example. Right now, about 9% of our workforce is unemployed. If we continue with the current policies, when these 9% of our population joins another work, work at another place, they will need to change their insurance. They will need to probably change their doctors. All their past data is like useless. And having 9-to-5 clinics fragments care. Proponents of electronic medical records will say that that will prevent fragmentation of care, and I will agree with them if there is one system or if all the systems freely talk to each other. All systems talking to each other freely is not going to happen. So if we have multiple systems not talking to each other, will be a worse scenario where the care will even be worse. Now imagine there is a company which has electronic medical records services, and they provide service to a hospital and 100 doctors. And for some reason the company goes bankrupt tomorrow because somebody like ran away with a lot of money, or something happened, somebody sued the company. Can you imagine if your EMR doesn't even open on a Monday morning and there's nobody you can contact, or say the FBI raided the premises and they can't start something or something? What I'm trying to tell you is the fragmentation in medical care is not only financially very expensive. It hurts. It hurts patients. It hurts you. It hurts me. And we have to minimize fragmentation. Probably we cannot 100% eliminate it unless the patient starts carrying a full copy of his or her record. But let's focus on this because it is costing us a lot of money and decreasing the quality of care that we receive. So correcting the fragmentation of healthcare that exists now gets an A plus in terms of priority from us. Regulate healthcare. By regulate healthcare, I mean let's have some sensible policies in terms of healthcare. Let those policies not be partisan. Let those policies not be narrow. Like for example, there can be a policy that anybody who wants to open a medical office or practice 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday to Friday cannot be in business of providing healthcare. So that is regulate healthcare. We don't need more government mandates to health plans to provide this or not provide that, because mandates don't work. They work in the short term. I gave you the example of breast cancer screening. There is almost a mandate that everybody should be given an opportunity to go for breast cancer screening, even if they have no money, but it is not working. So instead of mandates, let's come up with sensible policies which are for everybody's benefit, and then we will be able to get better outcomes from the healthcare industry. So to regulate healthcare sensibly gets a B minus from us in terms of priority. HMOs need to be punished strategy. See, those who were in the HMO who drank from the punch bowl have already left the party with hundreds to thousands of millions of dollars in their pocket, and nothing can be done about them. If we push the HMOs a lot, many in the HMO is not an individual, HMO is a company. So many will move from the HMO into, say, public health plan or cooperatives or something else. Or we punish HMO X, they will move to HMO Y. And it's middle and lower level workers who will have more difficulty because executives will always find a comparable job. If we decide to punish the HMOs financially, then I told you before, HMOs don't print money. They will pass on those fines to their insured members. We must remember one thing, that the debacle or disaster in our healthcare quality that has happened in the last few years or decades is, as much as it is HMO's fault, it is the fault of regulators who never demanded good quality care. Sounds familiar? So simply punishing the HMOs will just make our own life difficult. The HMOs will close down. We will have to find new HMO, new doctor. Many people will lose jobs when HMOs close down. You put financial burden on HMO, they will pass it on to the patients. You can't just like carve out an HMO and throw it out in the sea. No. HMO means they are part of our society. And there is a lot of talk about punishing them, beating them. Believe me, there is nothing that can be done to the HMOs without hurting the patients or medium or lower level employees in these HMOs. Can you send to jail anybody who made money by giving poor quality care or by denying care or doing all those things? If the answer is no, then you really can't do anything. Accept that fact. We are being punished for our laziness, for not demanding what was our right. And we deserve it in some ways. But now that we are aware that we made a mistake in the past those years, we have to learn a lesson. And the lesson is we have to demand from our state, from our federal government, from everybody, from our doctor, hospital, HMO, best quality care. And best quality care does not mean spending more money on your health care. Best quality care simply means the right care, and you have already paid for right care. In our other presentation on medical care gaps, you will see that everybody wants you to have the right care, be it the HMO, be it the government, be it anybody, because they save money when you get right care, when you remove MCGs or medical care gaps. So take it from me. You can't punish an HMO, really. HMO is a company which has people. Higher level people will leave, medium and lower level people will suffer, the patient's premiums will go up. So let's use them. Let's make everybody who is where stay there and correct their mistakes and work harder to provide us better service. If it makes sense to you, it's a wonderful idea. But think of consequences of punishing an HMO before you punish an HMO. And believe me, I am not a fan of HMOs. I know more about HMOs than most of you know. But I also know they can be used as a force for good if given the right direction. So the strategy of HMOs need to be punished gets a D from us. So the better solution is that HMOs need to be regulated, not punished. Today we are in a financial crisis. We cannot be blind and say, okay, we can spend any amount of money we want to spend. Just as we are not buying new things, we cannot afford totally new systems. So we have to use what we already have. And HMOs have done some good things, not many, but they have achieved cost containment by decreasing unnecessary admissions, decreasing inpatient days, cutting off the procedures which were not needed in most cases. For every story that you have heard, one story about HMO denying something to somebody, I can tell you 100,000 stories that they prevented a wrong procedure from happening which was not needed. That was the job they were given in the past, to cut on healthcare costs. They were never demanded to provide quality care. The problem happened that even though they worked on cutting costs in these areas, there was a party going on, and everybody took advantage of the situation. And by everybody, I mean everybody taking care of the patient jacked up their prices. It was like a domino effect. The pharmacy increased the price, the help plan increased, the hospital increased, the doctor increased, and the cycle was vicious, and the money was there. If there was no money, then it wouldn't have lasted so long. The problem is unregulated collapse of HMOs will lead to severe confusion and probably chaos even. And there's no good alternative out there. So maybe 5 years down the road will be a time to change the structure or dissolve HMOs or something. But right now, I believe personally that it is a time to regulate them better, that we can get what we need today instead of creating a new system which will not deliver results for 2, 3 years to come. So regulating the HMOs and not punishing them gets an A plus from us, A plus plus. Board to decide to deny medical care. Now, I don't think that this idea is true. I hope it is not, because if it is true, it is one of the worst ideas that I have ever heard during this debate. But again, as I said, it appears to be a misrepresentation of something which was presented in good faith. I don't know if it is deliberate or it is a misunderstanding. However, if it is true at all, then it's a very bad idea for the reason that those who are poor and disadvantaged and immigrants will be thought of as recyclable goods, and that we never want to do because we don't know what is next on the slippery slope. Even if anybody had an idea to do anything remotely like this, the resistance that the population has shown all over the country probably has put that idea to rest, that this is not a good idea. So this idea, if true, that a board will decide to deny medical care, gets an F from us. Mandatory do not resuscitate counseling. It is proposed that Medicare pays every 5 years for a session that the doctor can explain the patient his or her choices if the patient becomes incapacitated or suffers from an illness from which recovery is not possible. It is a thing which most doctors are already doing, that whenever a patient is admitted to the hospital, they are counseled and they are given the choice that if they do not want to be resuscitated, so that is already there. When you go to many of the doctor's offices, even the doctor's offices are doing it, but the problem is they are not getting paid. And the idea that they should be paid is a great idea because you are paying doctors for doing something that they were asked to do. I fully support it, but I have a question. I have a question that why should not everybody, irrespective of age, be asked to make a decision as to what need to be done to them if something happens? We hear of road traffic accidents every day where the person is totally incapacitated and is in irreversible coma, and then it becomes a very painful decision for the family, for the wife, for the parents, or anybody else. If the person is over 18,
sometimes even after 18, the parents end up making the decision because the person, they are the closest people to that patient. And it's very sad. So what I will tell you is that even if you are not in Medicare age, you make a decision. Whatever decision you make, it is your decision. But you make a decision and put it in writing and convey it to your doctor and your family members, near and dear ones, or at least somebody, as to what do you want done if you are irreversibly in coma or you cannot be resuscitated from your condition. And that should include if you want to donate your organs and all that. So it's a tremendous idea. There's nothing wrong with this idea. Many a times it happens when the patient enters the hospital, the patient is very sick. You don't want to be talking to patient because the patient can't understand or answer, or the patient is unconscious. And then it becomes a family feud many a times. Some people want to keep the person on life support, some people don't want to keep it on. And the worst thing that comes, that the physician who is taking care of the patient, the son says, keep him on the ventilator, and the daughter says, remove him. Now, what should the doctor do? And it becomes very difficult. Even if it is not so, the guilt of taking that decision always stays with the person who has made that decision. So it is your responsibility to make that decision about your own life. And I'm in no way telling you that you put that do not resuscitate or something, but you have to think that if such a thing happens that you cannot be resuscitated, what do you want done? Do you want to donate your organs? Do you want to remain on life support and suffer other complications like pneumonias, bed sores, or if you want to take any other approach? Again, the decision is yours, but this should be mandatory for everybody over the age of 18. So, this idea of mandatory do not resuscitate counseling is great. We give it a B priority. It is not something which need to be done today. So I hope you saw all these presentations that we had, and now you make up your list as to which ones you support, and then start working on them with your family and in your community. I am Dr. Anoop from Anoop Research and Multimedia. The discussion continues on YouTube at meandmyhealth.com, DOTCOM. And feel free to leave your point of view, because I will be able to answer in the best way that I can, that we can all understand each other better and can come up with a plan which will be the best for everyone.